was. So our blue planet, the Earth, has a dominance of the maritime domain, with over 70% of the Earth's surface covered by water, nearly 80% of the world's population living within 200 nautical miles of the coast, and nearly 90% of the world's trade transiting by sea. The Indian Ocean region has actually emerged as the world's economic and strategic center of gravity in the maritime domain. It is indeed the third largest water body, spanning an area of 68.5 million square kilometers. And countries on the rim of the Indian Ocean are home to nearly one-third of humanity. India, as we all know, occupies a very dominant position, if I may say that, in the Indian Ocean, as the country sits astride busy sea lines of communication over which nearly 120,000 ships transit every year, carrying 66% of the world's oil, 50% of the world's container traffic, and 33% of the world's cargo traffic. Nearly 1 billion tons of oil transits through the Indian Ocean every year. And these oil arteries and trade routes lead further east to the ASEAN, to countries like Japan, South Korea, and China. Our own details of India, you're aware, we have a long coastline of 7,516 kilometers. This coastline houses or harbors about 12 major ports and over 200 non-major ports. And 95% of our trade transits by sea. That is by volume, and 77% by value. About 18% of India lives in our coastal regions. And our 9 coastal states account for nearly 60% of the country's GDP. Incidentally, our seaborne trade accounts for nearly 30% of the country's GDP. So those are the kind of figures which are available. As I mentioned in the morning, in recent years, there has been a realization and awareness that we are a maritime nation. And for many, many decades, we've had the sea blindness of which Deepak and I talked in the morning. And I have had the occasion when we used to make those old-time presentations with those slides, OHP, overhead projector slides, to put the slide upside down. And then again, many of you who are trying to sleep now would wake up and say, oh, that's a slide upside down. And I would say, no, that is not a slide upside down. That is how we in India need to look outward at the seas which surrounds us from three sides. Because being in India, for whatever reason, as a maritime nation, we've had a continental fixation. But in recent years, one is very happy and delighted, particularly as a seafarer like me, who spent 45 years in uniform, to see that, you know, we are now gaining traction and once again, as I said, turning toward the seas. So which are the areas, ports and harbors? We will hear more a little later from our good friend, Mr. Sagarmala, who looks after the Sagarmala project. And as I said, this is a port-led development initiative, a huge initiative. You can't even imagine the scope of this project, which is over 100, sometimes I hear it's 150 projects, sometimes it's 500 projects. The investment is in the region of about $100 billion, and it will touch many, many areas. As you're aware, that we may have 95% of our trade transiting by sea, but actually we don't have a single transshipment hub in India. Our transshipment hubs are in Dubai, in Colombo, in Port Klang, in Singapore. And now transshipment hubs are coming up, which are going to be closer to the sea lines of communication. Connectivity is going to come up. Logistics aspects are going to improve. The connectivity with our inland waterways is going to improve, and that's a huge area. The other area is our shipping. We have 1,390 Indian flagships, to the best of my memory. But despite the fact that 95% of our trade transits by sea, only 7% is carried in Indian hulls. And the government is, of course, trying to give a lot of incentives to register ships in India, to have Indian flagships, but it's not an easy task. Because look at the requirement. We don't have a single LNG carrier which is an Indian flag carrier. We are running out of LPG carriers which are Indian flag. These are all managed by the SEI. And 80% of our oil requirements are imported. 40% of our gas requirements are imported. And if our biggest import is crude oil, what do you think our biggest export is? Petroleum products. And despite all that, we don't have Indian flagships. And this is an aspect related to energy security. Hence the impetus by the government not only to have Indian flagged and Indian registered ships, but also to build ships in India. And this is going to be, I feel, the next big revolution in this country. Because we will have to get over the syndrome of the past and start building ships here. We have 27 shipyards, but our share of the world's shipbuilding is a meager 0.17%. 0.17%. Nearly 85% of the world's shipbuilding today is carried out between South Korea, Japan, and China. Don't we have the capability? Of course we have. And today the capability is largely in the region of about 100,000 tons, whereas the norm is about 250,000 tons. So what do we need to build? I think the country needs to have a 30-year shipbuilding plan. Only then it will work. You can't have a five-year perspective, in this case at least, because it is an industry where it is huge potential. We can have these shipyards building these ships. And what do we need to build? This 30-year shipbuilding plan should decide. We should be building everything from LNG carriers to VLCCs to ships of large 10,000 TEU and above. We need to have coastal ships which are built in the country. Those will be the mid-category. And a country which makes aircraft carriers and nuclear submarines, for some strange reason, does not build deep-sea fishing trawlers. Only very recently we have started looking at the aspect, and you know, we have a shipyard in Cochin which is making something or looking at it. But what are the requirements? I mentioned to you that 90% of our fishing is restricted to our coastal areas, and we do hardly any fishing in deep waters. And therefore we have to turn that tide around and start building, along with a major 30-year shipbuilding plan, ranging from VLCCs to deep-sea fishing trawlers. And unless there is a long-term perspective, that is when the industry gets involved. That is when your employment takes place. That's where your skill development takes place. And remember one thing. These are going to be ships of the future. Therefore, they have to be built in accordance with the Energy Efficiency Design Index approved by the IMO. Therefore, they have to be built on the environment-friendly fuel. Why? We talked about the environment and the seas this morning. If you take the entire shipping of the world and you were to group it as a country, do you know that this shipping industry would be the sixth largest climate polluter on account of the CO2 emissions alone? This is the level of pollution. Just because our ships operate with the dirtiest of crude and emitting smoke all over the seas where nobody sees them, we don't see them. But this is the level of pollution that the entire shipping industry. So now it is, things are catching up, and we will have to see that the ships of the future run on environment friendly fuel. And I've heard our Honorable Shipping Minister on many occasions, and he has some great plans on the kind of fuel that we're going to have for the future. As we said, the next major area is in the area of our island development, developing our islands along the coast, developing our things for cruise tourism, development of marinas. The ambassador of Germany in Delhi is a yachtsman. And he met me and he said, Admiral, when I got my posting to India, I looked at the coastline, I looked at the islands, I looked at the lovely location. And he said, I thought I'll bring my yacht with me for this posting. He said, till I was horrified to find that there is not a single marina in India. In a small country, whether it's Germany, whether it's France, whether it's anywhere in Europe, you have hundreds of marinas. And here, apart from a small marina in Bolgatti Island in Kochi, there's not a single marina. Now things are coming up. And this is required. And one of the reasons, you know, when we had our friend on cruise tourism speak to us this morning, he said something and linked it with the rich and famous. This is exactly what we don't want to do. Yachting is a sport. Marinas are for going out to sea. And this is not a rich man's sport. The day we remove this tag and make it available to everybody, and I'll tell you, personal experience, I was the president of the Yachting Association of India as the Chief of Naval Staff, and we promoted yachting in a big way. Today, if you were to go to Tamil Nadu in Chennai on a Sunday, you will find hundreds of boats in the water with children, boys and girls taking part. How did we achieve that? We made all the mothers in charge of running the races. Normally, it's the mothers who hold back children, pani mein nahi jana, don't do this, don't do that. We invited all the mothers and say, here is your communication set, please run the races. And now you have that. So we have these yachting associations very live. Of course, Mumbai has always been very active. But in Bhopal, on the lake, they do that. In Hyderabad, we do that. In Gujarat. And yachting is coming up in a big way. So we would like this thing of marinas to come up, linked up with tourism, but not necessarily with the rich and famous tag. This is not a rich and famous tag issue. This is something that we need to have in our national character as part of being seafarers. And of course, as I said, the renewable sources of ocean energy is a big, big area and huge potential in India, whether you talk of the offshore wind, you talk of tidal wave energy, and the ocean thermal energy conversion. This is a unique technique, and I had some experience. As the Chief of the Navy, we commissioned a pilot project in our Andaman Nicobar Islands on ocean thermal energy conversion. What is it? The temperature on the surface of the water, in our waters, at least in the Bay of Bengal and otherwise, is about 24, 25 degrees. The temperature at 1,000 meters depth, and in the islands, particularly in the Andaman Nicobar, the depth, they are volcanic islands, so the depth just falls to 2,000, 3,000 meters. So at 1,000 meters, the temperature is 4 to 5 degrees. What do we have? When we pump out water from those depths, we have a temperature differential of 20 degrees centigrade. This differential of 20 degrees centigrade is used to evaporate ammonia, run turbines, and generate power. Ideal for the islands. Second, part of that technique that we are using in our Lakshadweep Island, incidentally, is to convert seawater into fresh water. Another huge advantage, when you pull out water from those depths, the water is so well oxygenated. I mentioned to you that, you know, the oceans are suppliers of oxygen. The water is so well oxygenated that if you were to use that water for aquaculture or for shrimp farming, your produce would be more than double. So such are the innovative things that we need to look at and look at harnessing the blue economy. While India is looking at the economic development of our maritime interests, we are also very, very conscious that we are a responsible country and we are going to do sustainable development. So as part of the United Nations document, Transforming Our World 2030 Agenda, there are the Sustainable Development Goals, and of that, the Sustainable Development Goal, SDG 14, is the one that actually provides the template for conservation of oceans, seas, and resources. India has made its National Voluntary Report to the United Nations, the High Level Political Forum, in July 2017, and there are many things that we have to do. While this is a step in the right direction, and while many countries have joined up on this 2030 agenda, we thought that 2030 is a long way off. You know, we'll do something. And there are some things that need to be done, not by 2030, but by 2020. And before we realize, we are in 2019 now. So 2020 is just next year. So I think that a lot more needs to be done, which means that our coastal areas, our approaches to ports, our ports themselves have to be marine pollution compliant. And there are many marinas here and people looking after the port authorities. It's not an easy task. So therefore, we have to look at, as I said, 80% of our pollution is coming from land. So where is all this filth coming in from our cities and major areas? So sewage treatment plants, et cetera, et cetera. So this is a huge area. And I think with that overview, I will now pass on to our specialist on the panel, Mr. Agarwal, who looks after the flagship project of the country as far as the maritime issues are concerned, which is Sagarmala. And I'll request him to please convey his views, how this is linked with our blue economy.
Thank you, Admiral Dhowan, colleagues on the dais and the dignitaries. Admiral Dhowan has very exhaustively given the overview of the blue economy and to a large extent the overview of the Sagarmala program. He has in fact covered the basic ingredients of the program beautifully. Maybe I'll elaborate something more on the port-led development, that is the Sagarmala program. I have a brief presentation. I think that will be better for the thing.
Oh, yeah.